Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
It's a cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
We have the tools, we have the talent. It's Miller time.
I said empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward, how much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth, but you gotta be willing to take the hits. And not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane. Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
It's showtime.
All right, welcome to Comic Book Radio. We're on during the day. It's not sunny here today, but it's not night, not night at all. We're usually on at 9 o'clock Eastern, so if you're checking your watches, don't worry. This is live. This is episode 130. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti, and today my guest is TRISHA CUFFARI, dannphan. You guys might know her as that on the YouTubes. We're going to be talking about creating and publishing indie manga. That's been a topic lately that's been on this channel more and more often, I'm noticing. People are into the manga and are creating it, talking about it, all that kind of stuff. So it's very interesting. I'm not well versed in manga, so I'm very curious about a lot of these different things, and what better guest than to discuss that with me today than TRISHA. Before we get started and bring her on, I want to say hello to those of you in the chat. We've got Revan Saber here. What's up, Revan Saber? Hope you're doing well. We got Levi Skeen. What's up, Levi? Thank you for being here. Robert is in the house. What's up, Robert? Hope you're doing good. Hex Allen is here. Hey, Hex. Sketchasaur Rex, how's it going, Sketchasaur? Holy Hand Grenades, what's up? It is, well, not yet, but will be. Ross Wolf, what's up, Ross? Thank you for being here. We got Manny Cornejo in the house as well. What's up, Manny? Golden Tree TV is here. What's up, Golden Tree? All right, so without further ado, I'm going to bring her on, the woman of the hour, Miss TRISHA CUFFARI. What's up, TRISHA?
Hi, how's it going?
It's going good. How are you?
Doing well.
That's
good. Ready to be talking about manga and comics.
Yeah, yeah. And the thing is that I've seen you grow as a creator over the past few years, and it's great to see. Things seem to be going very well. How's that going for you?
It's going good. I mean, you know, you do what you can with what you got, and you make things work.
Yes, Ross, she has a real name. Is there any particular focus that that you enjoy? The writing, the drawing, any part of it, the publishing?
I mean, the writing has always been a very big thing for me. Lately, I've been having a lot more fun during the drawing portions as I've, you know, picked up new techniques and now I get to apply them to some of my comics. So that's been very fun. And I'm glad that I'm having more fun while drawing, because then it turns out so much better than when you're just, like, super mechanical about the whole process.
Yeah, it's a strange thing, because you'll start, you'll be frustrated, and then you keep sticking at it, and then all of a sudden one day you look at something that you've made and you're like, I can draw.
Yeah, something like that.
It's strange how that happens. And even when you get away from it for a while, then you come back to it. Like this happened to me the other day. I was doing some commissions and all of a sudden I was working on one and I was like, oh, I haven't drawn in like 4 months. And then it just came back again after doing a couple of them. And I was like, oh, I can still draw. That's good.
It's relieving because you're worried, oh no, I'm out of practice. I'm going to draw something and it's going to look completely different from the stuff I was drawing before.
Absolutely. In terms of how you are building up your publishing label, which is, what's the name of that again?
Burning Star Comics.
Yeah, Burning Star. I've got the links in the description of the show in case you guys want to check it out. Also, if you're not subscribed to Dan Fan, of course, go subscribe. But how's that been for you? Being an up-and-coming indie manga publisher.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty exciting. I had already been publishing some other comics before that weren't necessarily mine. Just kind of people I knew who wanted a place to go to, just a host to, like, sell on, you know? And so now I'm kind of extending the reach and letting other people submit comics if they also want to just have a place to get their start. And so far it's been going pretty well. I've gotten some pretty fun submissions that I'll hopefully be releasing in 2024.
That's great. Anything that you're coming up against that you're like, man, I don't know what the heck, how to do that, that's difficult. Anything that's been an obstacle for you that you felt you had to overcome?
Well, printing is always kind of sketchy. There's a lot of different printing places to go to. I'd like to stay within America when it comes to printing. Mm. And some places are a little bit shady. But I'm hoping that I can find better new places to go find to get stuff printed and get better prices and hopefully better quality.
That's great. What's the format primarily of the stuff that you're printing, like the size, the paper, that kind of a thing?
So a lot of submissions are kind of a little all over the place so far, but I would like to start printing stuff the way that a lot of manga has been printing stuff, which is, you know, this size, the size that actually fits on a bookshelf, and black and white interiors. Which is cheap, but effective when it comes to a lot of storytelling and kind of pushes you to create more contrast in your artwork as you're telling the story. So I'd like to do more books like that, at least in the future. Like I'm coming up with a new comic series that I'm hoping to do as like my main thing next year, and that's called Reaper. And I'm going to do it in that format and see how it goes.
Very nice. I'm curious as far as the printers you're using. At Alterna, we used to primarily print graphic novels, which is just a different size format, obviously, than what you're doing. But it's the same sort of thing and the same kind of paper stock and things like that. We used to have graphic novels that were primarily just black and white. Didn't really do color for the longest time. And I'm really wondering if you are coming up against difficulties with a printer, let me know. I can make some recommendations for you.
That would be awesome.
Yeah. We'll do that after the show.
Sure.
But industry secrets, you know, you got to kind of keep these things close to the vest. So we got a question here from Sketchosaur Rex. Wants to know, how'd you come up with the name Burning Star?
That came from some focus grouping. I was spitballing a bunch of names. But I like how it turned out in the end. I like my little star logo that I got going for it. Feels like, you know, Goku powering up. And, you know, that's kind of the style of story that I want to go for when it comes to, like, inspiring, motivating type stories that we're going to be publishing.
Oh, very nice. Yeah, I dig it, too. It sounds cool. Allison says, American Manga Publishing. Sign me up. There you go. Hey, yeah, we print in the U.S. I only used a printer in China once, years ago, and regretted every second of it.
Oh, yeah.
So never again. Never again. And it was because at the time, I was being almost like too convinced into like, oh, we'll go with that, you know, it's cheaper and blah blah blah, and then and the shipping time was horrendous, the customs stuff was horrendous. They didn't do a bad job printing the book or anything, and it wasn't really that much cheaper. Like, after looking at it, it wasn't that much cheaper than if we had just gone with a printer in the US and never worked with one again and went back to just using printers in the US.
Yeah, so, I can imagine that the shipping would be so much worse.
Yeah, it kind of offset for the quantity we were doing. It kind of offset any of the savings. But the biggest hassle was when the shipment was being kept at customs for 3 months. So the books are just sitting there. And you never know. They don't tell you, like, oh, in 3 months we'll release these. You just don't know when they're going to release them. So there was one instance where we almost completely missed, when we were at Diamond at the time, we almost completely missed the deadline to get the books to Diamond, which would have resulted in a cancellation and a refunding of those books. So once you deal with, like, distribution, I don't recommend doing that. I don't know what publishers do, and they do whatever they gotta do, but I never liked one second of it. So never again. And that was years ago, though, like almost 10 years at this point.
Yeah, you've learned and grown from that experience.
Exactly. And so how long has Burning Star been around?
A couple years now, but now there's, like, more substance to it. Like, we're adding more stuff and we're trying to expand to get more people on board.
Very nice. And again, guys, the website link is in the description of the show if you want to check out the site. What kind of stuff are you primarily looking to publish? What kind of genre and content?
I'd like to get more positive stories is the main thing. I don't want the Burning Star label to necessarily be attached to something that's going to bum people out at the end of reading it.
Oh, okay.
So the main things, I guess, are, you know, shonen type action stories or some comedies or, you know, romances are the big thing that I would like to see more of on the website.
Very nice. Very nice. Let's see. Sketcher says it's cool. I think I thought of the Mario Power Star powering up, like Goku seeing it. It came across. That's interesting. Allison wonders, is it primarily shonen?
Yeah, there's a couple of, like, action stories on there. I'd like to get more shonen, of course. There's definitely a lot of people who want to try their hand at doing those types of shonen manga stories.
And Jenko wants to know, how did you get so much better at art in such a short period of time?
I just picked up a method of practicing better. Sometimes, you know, the art advice everyone gives is just draw, but there's a lot more to it than that that kind of depends on person to person what's going to work for them. A big thing I started doing recently is just, like, taking a picture from a manga or an anime that I enjoyed and side by side drawing it out, and then taking what I learned from how they draw particular things and then applying it to a brand new picture that I then draw. And then once again, you know, comparing it side by side to see, oh, this is how you do this and that, and this is what the proportions look like.
Yeah,
so that has helped me a lot.
I used to fill up, like, mini notebooks, just really cheap, like, dollar notebooks with body parts.
Yeah, I did the same for sure.
Yeah, just like analyzing and drawing different body parts in different ways, different angles, all that over and over and over. Like I had a whole notebook full of hands, a whole notebook full of eyes, a whole notebook full of mouths. And you know, I'm sure if someone stumbled upon those notebooks and out of context, they would think very ill thoughts of me.
It's difficult being an artist and looking up all the reference material.
And then combine it.
You're searching very odd things.
Yeah. Combine it with your internet search history, especially if you're a writer and you want to look up all kinds of different ways and you're studying psychology and philosophy. Hopefully. All of a sudden,
how to make
you're...
a bomb.
Yeah, it all turns into, great, I'm on a watch list now.
Yeah.
All because of comics. Thanks, comics. Gerald says, observational drawing from life and reference is the key to growth. Then imagination has a library to seek work from. Yeah, that's very true. You get that inner, that mental catalog of reference files. But so when you're starting out with all of this, when you're putting together your own stories, what kind of stuff occurs in that process? How do you get your ideas, and then how do you manifest those ideas and then isolate them and turn them into workable stories?
Typically, you know, you get the idea for something, and then you have to expand upon that idea and turn it into something tangible. So I usually start off with just some dummy title and an outline, just going through what scene to scene would look like and how we reach certain points in the story. And then I start actually putting together character designs and a script, or sometimes just go straight to draft, drawing out all the pages and seeing how that looks like. And then there's a whole lot of editing involved and passing it around to different people, get their general opinions on it. It's a lot easier to pass around something when you have the draft pages as opposed to a script. Sometimes people don't really understand what they're looking at when they're looking at a script. But yeah, and then it's all cutting, pages out, pages added in, different dialogue choices. The dialogue is the easiest thing to change, of course. It's the easiest thing to change up at the end. But there's a lot of editing to do when it's still in the draft stages, for sure.
Yeah, yeah. But the plot and everything else, yeah, that's true. How long are the books usually that you're creating?
I've created a couple of various different lengths. We're getting bigger and bigger in size as I've done more comics. Like, it's not like Getting a Job Will Kill You, 30 pages. And then I did Horizon Quest with Adam. That was more like 60 pages. And now the new book, Reaper, that's going to go for 100 pages. So bumping up in size, it's almost like you're getting to the next level, fighting the next boss that's like harder and harder. But yeah, doing a 100-page comic has been quite something.
Are you doing that on your own?
Yeah, that's all me.
Wow. You're crazy.
Yeah, right. But so far I've been making decent progress. I'm about halfway through. So
that's great.
Yeah.
Man, fantastic. Jeez. There's no way I'm not even gonna do a 20 to 30 pager on my own. No. No, not happening. I'm gonna hire someone to do that art.
You need so a lot of time on your hands, that's for sure.
Well, it absolutely takes a lot of time, that's for sure. So you could create your stories in any kind of medium whatsoever. Why comics? Why manga?
Well, comics are their own art form in general. And with any art form, it just kind of depends on like your own personal perception, what you enjoy to look at the most. In a way, comics are like the stepping stone before animation, where you can just take a frame and just look at it for a very long time and just enjoy it, rather than, you know, pausing the animation and just looking at one shot for a very long time, right? I've always loved animation, don't get me wrong, but comics is the easier option when it comes to, am I going to do a book or am I going to, like, animate an entire movie? Yeah, I'll go with the book for sure.
It's like an in-between, right? You know?
Yeah. But I do love doing comics. I've gotten very much into manga over the years. I blast through a new series, like, every month at this point. And while keeping up with the current series, which is what you... That's like a job, you know? Like, keep up with the newest chapter as soon as it comes out. Because they come out so quickly when it comes to manga. They're working hard over there.
Oh, yeah. They work real fast. Really fast. I do have a question here from Slim Crow. It says, how do you construct a character interaction or dynamic that doesn't seem forced?
Well, it also has to do with how you construct the characters themselves. You have to keep in mind what their personalities are and how they're gonna bounce off of each other, how personalities clash. And yeah, I definitely have written stories in the past where the dialogue was super lame. And taking inspiration from real conversations or other media will definitely help with figuring out exactly how to get two characters to interact with each other more naturally.
Yeah, I agree. What kind of stuff in particular do you look at? Oh, geez, these people. Holy hand grenades. Her hair is nicer than mine. Her hair is nicer than... This is all just attached to the hats I wear. I'm completely and utterly bald. And that's the thing, you know, when you're making comics, especially when you become a publisher, you don't have time for haircuts. So you're either lucky and you're bald, or you're just gonna let your hair grow out. It's one or the other. So for you, in terms of what you're getting inspiration from, that's outside of the genre, because this is always some of my most enjoyable aspects of the conversations I have with the creators that come on here. I like knowing what inspires them, what influences them outside of within creating itself or the genre that they're working in or even the medium. What are some of the things that you've drawn inspiration from or that have helped you to create your characters and stories?
Right. A lot of the classic answers would be like, oh, these list of movies I've seen or the list of video games I've played. And those definitely have played their role. But also, I feel like the part that people maybe forget to add a credit to is the stuff in real life, right? Mm. I vacationed at this nice mansion in right here in New Jersey, actually. You wouldn't expect such a beautiful mansion to be around here, but you can actually, like, stay there and look around, and it's nice. And there's just so many wonderful details around just the beauty of it all. They had, like, this nice outdoor pond and gardens and everything, and just looking around at that, it was really inspiring me for writing fantasy stuff.
Yeah. How'd you come across that?
Yeah, I actually... just one Google search found it. And I was like, oh man, we gotta stay here at least one night, you know?
Is that like an Airbnb sort of thing?
It's kinda a mansion converted into a hotel.
Wow.
It's like historical or something.
Wow. Was it haunted?
No. But it was very beautiful. Very old. They need some renovations here and there, but you know, it was quite the experience. And like getting out there and doing stuff and having fun and having those experiences definitely also play a part when it comes to inspiring yourself to create something.
That's great. That's incredible. I can only imagine being in that surrounding. I feel the same way up here with seeing mountains and, you know, being around nature and that kind of a thing.
It's very true.
Yeah. And then a lot of old architecture, obviously. I'm in New Hampshire, but just New England in general, a lot of old architecture where it's like stuff that you just look at it and you just invent stories just looking at it, thinking like, how did people live in this? How did they, you know, how'd they create this? What was life like on here?
Yeah. I definitely want to eventually move to a more mountainy area, because that seems like that's the peak place to be if you want to write fantasy, right? If you can't live in Germany, you got to at least live in a very mountainesque, beautiful area.
And if you can live on a mountain, even better.
Now you're thinking.
People do around here. You ever look up like mountain homes? There's a bunch of mountain homes in the White Mountains of New Hampshire. And these things are incredible. They're like $11 million. And it's like living on a resort. They got like 20 rooms. They got a whole, like two indoor pools, that kind of deal. And incredible. I can't even imagine.
They're living their best life for sure.
I suppose so, man. I gotta work harder. Can I live in just like the shed of that mountain? You know, I'm sure the shed's probably like at least two bedrooms, probably like three times the size of what I'm in right now. You know,
right.
Yeah. As long as there's Wi-Fi and a road, you're all set.
We'll make it work. We'll live in one of those tiny houses.
Yeah, yeah. You know, that'd be fine for me. You know, I think that'd work out. So being inspired by real life and various locations, has that worked itself directly? Like, did you put that mansion directly into a story, or at least like the inspirations coming from that location?
Well, naturally, I did take a bunch of photos when I was vacationing there for that bit of time. And when it came to doing the interiors for Reaper, because he goes to this, you know, abandoned castle in the story, and I definitely was taking a lot of inspiration from the stuff that I had seen in the mansion, and kind of not exactly like copy-pasting, but applying the same type of love and care to like the details of the architecture and everything into the story. And it actually made it more fun to do backgrounds. When I had those details and I had that inspiration in mind while I was drawing, I used to absolutely despise drawing backgrounds. But once I was inspired to do so, and once I had that passion inserted into me after like enjoying what it looks like in real life, then I wanted to do it and I wanted to get better at it. And I think that has improved my background drawing.
Would you say that that was something that was difficult for you before, like drawing architecture or locations and scenes like that?
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, I had no idea what I was doing. I have one of those books where they kind of, it's some sort of architecture book. I don't remember the exact name of it. I think it's like The Art of Architecture, and you know, detail exactly how different architecture from around the world is all like pieced together, and math behind it and everything, and all the itty bitty little details. And that was good for like something to look at and be like, so that's how this is all working and functioning. But it wasn't the same as actually seeing it in real life and actually, you know, looking at the beauty of it. That's what really inspired me to put a lot of effort into it.
Absolutely. Holy Hand Grenade says audio. I'm hearing you fine. If we're having audio issues with everybody, for anybody else, please let us know. So that brings me to a really pertinent question, because I'm seeing a lot of this, and I think you probably are too, in terms of people who are not having much life experience outside of their own personal, very small life experience. Not looking outward, they're not looking to, you know, understand people outside themselves, and then they're going into storytelling in particular. And I think it's really hindering the quality of storytelling that gets out there. Are you noticing anything like that as well?
Yeah, I can definitely see that in a lot of different stories, where it's more so about repeating the same thing that they've seen in other places or in other specific types of media that they've seen, and just repeat, and not actually trying to have new experiences or trying to tell a new type of story or, you know, stuff like that. Sometimes people just get, like, really stuck doing one type of thing. Or just really stuck only seeing one certain opinion.
Yeah. Because it seems like there's a lot of people who... And we see this across the board, where they're getting inspired by whatever came before storytelling-wise or whatever they're seeing, and they're emulating it in terms of what they see on TV or movies or within the stuff they read or whatever it might be, as opposed to actually getting outside of that kind of material and building upon and making something that's unique or something that transcends them. I think we're kind of stuck in a weird feedback loop where, you know, the reboots and retcons and remakes of remakes and all that kind of stuff. And it's very strange. What are your thoughts on that and why that is occurring?
Yeah, I mean, some studios definitely are trying to cash in on what they believe is a safe thing. And so they are basically writing stories that feel like they were written by algorithms, where it's just an amalgamation of, like, everything that has succeeded in the past, but there's no soul to it. There's no, like, inspiration behind it, like I was mentioning with, like, seeing architecture in a book versus seeing it in real life. And another thing is, I think a lot of, there's a lot of fan fiction stories out there that are written by, like, teenagers who are just kind of vomiting out stuff that they saw and liked in a book, but they don't really understand why it works so well in the book that they read and why it's not working so well in the fan fiction that they're writing. I notice it so much with a lot of teenage writing, and sometimes it's just because they haven't had many experiences in life yet. So they haven't come to really understanding what they're putting out there. And I think you could kind of say the same about a lot of the reboots and the movies and all, everything that comes out that's like trying to cash in on something that worked in the past, but they don't really understand why it worked in the past.
Yeah. And I forgive that with the young. I don't forgive it with people who are like 30 plus. Want to be, yeah. you know, in their 20s, I'm like, all right, you know, you're still kind of figuring some things out. Okay. But once you're hitting into your 30s and beyond, I mean, there's people that are like 50 to 60 years old that are still, I think, maybe trying to be cool with the kids and trying to be like, well, if I write stuff that seems like they would write, then they'll buy it, you know, and that's not going to do anybody any favors. But alas, I think some people do think that way. But we're seeing something that's bigger than that. So in terms of why that's happening, in terms of why you think overall there seems to be more emphasis on a lack of creativity, a lack of wanting to take a risk, when it seems like there should be risks left and right nowadays among certain corporations within these characters and these genres, because everyone is way more familiar with them. So you should be more comfortable in saying, okay, they know what that is. We can tell a deeper story with that. Why do you think that's occurring? Why do you think we are less willing, or at least they are less willing to take risks with that kind of stuff?
Well, you could certainly relate it to how the culture has shifted and changed over time. You know, people more so willing to get offended and upset over things. Mm. And maybe some people think, well, I gotta do what's safe then, what won't offend anybody. Or, you know, because of how divided, especially the U.S. is, people are thinking, well, I gotta do the safe thing that's worked in the past, or I gotta take the thing that's worked in the past and make it safe for today's world so that it won't upsetty anybody.
It's you ever see that South Park episode when they're putting together the holiday play?
I think that's the one that I haven't seen.
Oh, yeah. It's from years ago. when practically every episode of South Park was great. Nowadays, it's kind of, some of them are solid, and then others, it's like it fizzles out. But
hit or miss.
Yeah. This one in particular was about, they want to put on basically like a Christmas play, and it starts offending people. Every single aspect of everything was offending someone. And then at the very end, I think they're all dressed in like black. And it's a very solemn, and they're just like a happy holiday, or like holiday, something very, very just unbelievably inoffensive, but ridiculously boring, and there's no point to it. And the whole thing is not even what the original intent was all about. And it feels like that's how some people now want to see things be created, whether they realize it or not. Because it is that level of like, well, I'm kind of upset that happened with that, and that offends me.
Right. I can definitely see that.
Yeah, it's interesting how that occurs. Is there anything for you? What offends you? So what do you see that's out there right now where you're offended by it and you're like, they shouldn't do that. I wish they wouldn't.
Yeah, there's definitely stuff out there like that. Definitely a lot of stories that I invested time in reading, and then it just disappointed in the end. I think what really like gets under my skin is when it's promoting something completely immoral, like objectively immoral, not just that I have a stick up my ass or something. But that really gets me, you know.
What would be one of those topics for you?
Oh, God. Oh, man. Well, the most recent review that I have on my head is when I reviewed this manga that was kind of like pro-incest. And that was, yeah, not the best thing that I wanted to read, exactly.
Hmm. Like, advocating for it? That kind of a thing?
Yeah, kind of. It was just kind of like, it doesn't matter.
Incest love is A-OK. Love.
Yeah, exactly right.
You know, it's funny you say that because I'm seeing more and more commercials and other kinds of things being made where it's like a joke, but it's not a joke. You know, that kind of like it's implied that these siblings are doing things. And and I'm like, what is the point of this? What are they trying to push? You know, it's an odd way to try to sell your product.
Right.
Yeah, it's incest is wincest. Good grief. Yeah, you know that's up there. That's up there. And the thing is, you can have these topics in a story, but I don't think that it is strange to put almost like a propagandic spin on it in terms of trying to brainwash the person into thinking, no, this is great. That's good.
I'm not against people being able to write it, but if you're going to like promote something that's bad, then I'm going to be appropriately disgusted. There's also like the one of the DC YA comics that I reviewed. You know, you had teenage Catwoman cutting herself and like being like, I don't need anybody, I don't need any help, I'm gonna just choose to be homeless even though all these people are offering to help me, I'm gonna deny all their help. That's the right thing to do. And it's like, no, that's not the right thing to do.
There wasn't like a lesson help. There wasn't a lesson there of like her having that attitude and then it proving to be the wrong attitude.
No, it ends with her still being homeless and still denying people's help and being like, I'm going to do it on my own.
She's self-made.
Yeah, right.
Wow. Is that a one and done? Is that a part of a series?
That was a one and done. That was one of the DC YA graphic novels.
They should just leave it a DC Y. Like, why am I making this? Why am I reading it?
Correct. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. That's horrible. Does anybody else know what that book that Trisha's talking about is? I mean, and I'm not saying that I don't believe you, but that's insane.
That was I did a read through of it, and it was Catwoman Under the Moon.
Oh my lord.
I was really surprised, too, because when I first read, like, the free Comic Book Day version of it, it, you know, it was bad, but I didn't think it was going to get that bad.
Yeah, that's so strange, because that's a compelling thing to put that in there as a character development moment. You know, obviously, you got to have a character and put them through things. Otherwise, if it's just this constant, you know, it's boring. So you got to put them through the ringer. And if you're going to have a morality lesson being taught, you have to kind of put their morality questionable. And then hopefully there's something that's taught either to them or there's an experience played throughout the story with someone else that parallels it or whatever. But this kind of thing, that's disturbing that would even be created and put out there.
Well, yeah, especially for teenagers, right?
Yeah. Because that's a path that leads towards very, very bad things, especially to teenage girls. That's a path that leads towards human trafficking and towards all sorts of bad, horrible things. That's not something to encourage or glamorize. And I'm noticing this too. Slim Crow says it. Low-key innuendo to moral depravity is popping up in a lot of things. It's very strange. We're approaching biblical levels of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Yeah, people taking the term freedom to the extreme.
Yes, yeah, it's strange to see that occur. All I gotta say is when we are smited, please, please understand certain people were not for that.
Right.
Good grief. ODF says superheroes no longer save the world, they corrupt norms. And that's strange because it's storytelling is very powerful. Obviously, you know that. So what stories over the years have inspired you where, you know, when you were feeling maybe not at your best or at a low point and certain characters, certain stories really kind of helped to bring you out of that or to inspire you?
Yeah, I mean, there is a ton. There's a lot of stuff that I just, like, would watch and have on, and it would be, like, fun to have on, right? And then there's stuff where there's a nice little lesson in there. I always appreciate the little lessons. I've enjoyed a lot of romance manga, especially. And, I mean, you know, the manga in the back. I like to display the stuff I especially enjoy the most. Trying to think of a specific thing, and I guess, like, I might as well just take one out and show, since it's, like, all displayed out. Free Ren is a new one that I've really been enjoying. It's kind of about, like, the main character kind of learning to accept death while also, how would I even describe it? But appreciating life more, especially. And the plot is something that I haven't really quite seen a lot of in a lot of other fantasy manga that I've read, where their overarching journey, you know, they beat bad guys along the way, and they defeat demons along the way, but they're also searching for the truth behind God and heaven. And that is something that you don't normally see in a lot of manga out there. So, really interested to see where the story goes. Of course, it is ongoing. I don't know how it ends quite yet, but I've been really enjoying the intelligence and the inspiring moments behind this series, and a lot of wholesome moments, of course.
That's great. Yeah, it's I think that's just an intrinsic part of human nature, right? To wonder about things that are seemingly more divine or surpass us. It's something I think that is being discouraged too lately. So I think what you're talking about in terms of seeing that within a book, especially, how old is that book, would you say?
When the first book came out, not quite sure. It was at least like a couple of years ago. It's a fairly new series. Okay.
Yeah, so then, yeah, that really is something that you don't see too much as a theme being explored nowadays in modern storytelling. It was explored like crazy. for the longest time, for decades and decades.
But it's really refreshing to see a return to form type of story. It's like when everyone's trying to subvert and do the opposite, then that becomes the new norm, and now just doing the normal thing is crazy subversion, you know?
Yeah. It's strange. It kind of ties back into a little bit of what we were just talking about in terms of the mentality that's getting pushed among storytelling nowadays. So when you're seeing stuff like this happen, what are you doing as a creator to counter that?
Well, a lot of the way that you can kind of counter something that you dislike becoming more and more popular is to then flood the market with things that you like, things that you would improve of. So Burning Star, what I want to be is the inspiring place for a lot of people to go to. I see a lot of stories out there that are more so pessimistic, not really inspiring, kind of more so doomer stuff, a lot of it out there. Everyone's trying doomer. To be super edgy and sad and like, oh, the world sucks, the end. And that's not really what I want to go for. I want people out there to read something and then when they put it down, feel good. Like, go through life feeling better about themselves. Part of the reason, you know, since it's December, might as well bring this up, but part of the reason everybody loves Christmas time so much is because everyone is generally in a better mood. And everyone's nicer to each other, and everything looks pretty. And why can't we just have that also with our media? Why can't we have that with comics and movies and TV shows all year round? Why can't we just create something that makes people feel better and act better towards one another?
Yeah. Why can't Christmas be every day?
Yes.
Yeah. Just like that song by, you know, ELO?
Mm-mm.
Oh, you gotta listen to some ELO, Electric Light Orchestra. The song created by Wizard, which is from one of the members of ELO, his song is I Wish It Could Be Christmas Every Day. You gotta go listen to that. You're gonna listen to that and go, man, yeah, it's good stuff. Old school. Not super old school, but old school. But yeah, go listen to some ELO. ELO is awesome. ODF says, bah humbug. You probably know of ELO, the song Evil Woman. You ever hear that?
Oh, yeah, heard that one.
Mr. Blue Sky, that kind of thing. Yeah, that's been in a bunch of different, but they got so many great, great songs. So that's a great point that you bring up in terms of wanting to offer something that is, I guess, like anti to the anti.
Yeah, in a way, I guess it is. It's a revolution against the revolution.
Yeah, and in a way, I don't know how well-versed you are in terms of the history of pop culture and modern storytelling throughout movies, music, books, and comics, but it seems like we're getting into a period of time that's closer to the late 70s, early 80s, where we're getting out of the doldrums and the doom and gloom, which mirrored kind of like the 70s to like 75, 76. And now it seems like there's creators, and it's a very similar kind of thing because there's a lot of creators at that point in time where they were taking the ability to create and get their stories out there, and they were tired of seeing the anti-this, anti-that, everything sucks, the world is horrible, people are horrible, you know, hate everybody, hate yourself, you know, and that's the storytelling. And it turned more into about trying to overcome that. Yeah, okay, you know, there are things in your way. Life isn't easy. The world can suck, but here's something inspiring of people who are trying to do something better for themselves, for each other, for the world around them. And I feel like we're starting to get into that phase of storytelling. And it's starting like it did back then. It's starting at the ground level with more independent creators. How long do you think, for some of your stories, how long do you have them projected out?
You mean like for the series type things?
Yeah, like in terms of what you're doing and like how many issues or how many years do you foresee some of them ideally being around for?
So, Sonic City Witch, she's got one more issue left, and a lot of the other stories that I've written are more so, like, one-shots, so it's like, I can continue it if I want to, but I can just also leave it as it is. Reaper is the first, like, real long-term series that I'm gonna be diving into, and I've got the first three books kind of figured out for that so far, but of course, you know, a lot of time to dedicate towards 100-page books that you're putting out there. And of course, there's also some other people coming on board the publisher, and they've got, some of them are going to be mini-series, but, you know, overall, I'd like to publish a lot more one-shots. I think there's a lot that you can achieve in telling, like, a story that can stand alone and doesn't have a to-be-continued at the end. Like, it could continue, but it can also just stand strong as it is without being a full-fledged series. So there's some of those.
Speak in my language. I love that stuff.
Yeah, right.
I love that. I'm bringing that into King Cryptid in a big way. I think that's kind of great, too, because it makes it so accessible where you can go and get into whatever. Like, if you do a series out of it, you can access anything, any book, you know, and not feel lost and feel like you read and enjoyed a complete story.
Right.
Do you have any favorites that are like that? Any type of series, or whether it's anime, manga, comics, anything like that, where you can point to it and say that you think, like, they do that really well?
Yeah. I mean, as far as something that can just, like, stand on its own, there's definitely a lot of shorter anime out there that some, you know, like, OVA-style stuff that people fly past sometimes. Alita has a pretty great standalone OVA anime movie. Of course, they also have the live-action movie, which is also very good. And there's this other one that I've been watching lately. It's only like three episodes, but I've seen two of the three episodes, so I think that's enough to recommend it. And it's Gunsmith Cats.
Oh, that, yeah. I know people really love that. Yeah. I saw an episode. It's good, yeah.
Yeah, it's like short, but it's very effective at, like, doing what it needs to do in that short amount of time, and it stands really strong on its own. Even if you just watched one episode, it's, like, great.
Yeah, totally. Let's see, Nico says, I gotta read it. I've seen those around. I'm pretty sure my comic shop has a lot of old school manga that was imported to the U.S. through, like, Dark Horse and a couple other publishers, and they've got, like, those in the 50-cent bin. I should just pick a bunch of those up.
Oh my god, I would rob them probably out of all of their manga. Trove.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think they even know what they have. It's all just, like, buried, and they have so many 50-cent bins. It's insane. Piles and piles and piles of books. And one day I was looking at all the long boxes, and they got just a ton. They got, like, maybe 8 long boxes full of that stuff.
Oh, like, my goodness. Yeah. That sounds amazing.
Yeah, yeah. If anyone wants to know, if you're in the area, it's Chris's Comics in Seabrook, New Hampshire. Next time I go, they'll be cleared out. Yeah, they got an overwhelming amount of 50-cent comics. It's incredible. So what's up next for you in terms of in the immediate future? I'd say probably for 2024 in terms of what you're doing with publishing and creating.
Well, next we are putting out a good schedule, and the plan is to be opening up submissions, like, for a few months every year to plan for next year's, like, publishing roster. And that should be fun. Of course, I'm working on finishing up the one series while starting a new series, and I've got a couple other one-shots, like, just in the pocket. If I ever want to do something in between, you know, doing my fantasy series, I just pop out one of those and get something nice and easy for people to read without committing to a full series, you know?
That's great.
So, yeah, that's kind of generally what the plans are moving forward. Just increasing the amount of stuff on the website for people to read, making sure it's all, like, positive stuff that you're not going to feel bummed out after reading. And I also want to do more videos on the Burning Star channel. I've been neglecting it a little bit.
very nice. Well, it's awesome to see you continue to grow and improve and get stuff out there over time. I'm looking forward to seeing the progress of you and your publishing label. I think it's really cool. I remember years ago when you had submitted something to Alterna and I rejected it. And I can't ever really say too often that I'm happy to see where people came and went after I rejected a submission. Because I've received a lot of submissions, and probably less than I can count on one hand, I can go, it's awesome to see that they continued and got better and better and better. And you're one of those people. So I'm glad to see that. I'm glad you stuck with it. I'm glad that you are doing great and keep it up. I can only imagine the next 5 years or so, you're going to be even better than you are right now. So keep it up, Trisha. Doing a good job.
Thank you.
You're absolutely welcome. Proud of you. Everybody, you guys can go and check out any of the links in the description of the show. If you want to learn more about Trisha's company, if you want to go subscribe to her YouTube channel, all that good stuff. And where can they find you?
You can find me on YouTube with dannphan. You can find me on Twitter at Trisha CUFFARI. And I'm also on Instagram, but not as often posting on there. And of course, burningstarcomics.net, where you can find all the comics that we've put out so far.
There you go. Fantastic. Other than that, thank you guys for being here tonight or today. I'm not going to be on tonight, of course, but I'll be back again tomorrow night at 9 o'clock Eastern with Edwin Acevedo. And we're going to be talking about his comic and his thoughts on creating. All of his stuff that he's working on is very interesting. I don't know if you know, Edwin? You know of Edwin?
I don't.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, he's a talented dude. Busy dude. Everybody's busy doing and creating their own stuff. It's great to see lately. But thank you again, Trisha, for your time and for being on here today. Really appreciate it. Everybody in the chat, thank you guys as well. Appreciate you guys being here. Ross says, Pete rejected Trisha. Drama! No drama. I'm proud of her. I'm glad to see her succeeding and doing what she does and loving every minute of it. It looks great. Everybody, again, go check out everything in the description of the show. And until then, until tomorrow, everybody have a great day, a great night, and an even better tomorrow. See you guys real soon. Take it easy.